remarkable fellow, we found him and wanted more, but what we could get, we took, and we found that this one piece was most arresting, because you can enjoy all of Washington and see such exquisite, we were the third national park, property park, see such exquisite natural areas, but if we don't address what's going on and what we're causing in terms of climate change, we're going to wind up with tropical growth overgrowing the Lincoln Memorial, and it will be on fire. True?
True.
What do you think?
I can't go into it.
Tell us why you came to that meeting.
So, well, first of all, thank you everybody for coming out. This is a great showing, great crowd. Thank you. Such a nice evening. I also want to thank Amy for hosting us. And this gallery is so beautiful. But anyway, so why did I paint this? During the day, I'm a city planner. So for 13 years, I was a city planner for the DC Office of Planning. And I was mostly a planner for the downtown area, even though for a few years. So I have been looking at the ball on a daily basis, all the maps that you can see out there, including floodplain maps. And the ball is actually included in one of the, if not the biggest, actually the biggest floodplain in the district. There's a crazy floodplain that nobody thinks about too much as residents, because you don't think about it, you don't see it, that goes from 17th Street and kind of crosses over, touches a little bit on the White House, and comes down to Southwest and Buzzard Point. And so you can be a mile and a half inland from any of our rivers and still be in a floodplain. That's because we changed the landscape of the district so much through centuries, through dredging. A lot of the land of the mall was water for a long time. A lot of the creeks that used to cross the district have been channeled and completely paved over.
We're going to press pause for a second.
Yep.
Because this gentleman, aside from being a really beautiful painter, is also an industrial planner and has worked for the DC government, now works for the DC Department of Energy and Environment. Before that was with the Office of Planning.
Yeah.
Until quite recently. 13
years ago. Yeah, so just recently I started a new job where basically I work on planning, replanning the district to be flood resilient. So we look a lot at the mall, but we especially obviously focus on areas for residency. But that's my day job, so I look about sea level rise projections and how they might affect the district. That's why you know, some of my paintings are a little bit not so positive looking. But there are things we're doing as a district to you know, to protect us from that. But also my background is I was born in Rome, in Italy. So I'm kind of used to like walking around a once glorious capital of a once glorious empire. And a city that is dotted when Lincoln Memorials look alike, or well, the Lincoln Memorial is a look alike of Roman buildings, etc. Right? So that's how I grew up, and I grew up in ruins. And so I often look at the Lincoln Memorial and look at the mall, thinking about how will people experience this space 500 years from now, 1,000 years from now? Is there a giant like white guy sitting on the chair in the Lincoln Memorial? What was he doing? Why is there an African obelisk in the middle of the district? So there are all these questions about symbols, symbols of power. And so if you want to do a thinking about climate change and the impact of climate change on the US, I think the mall is a great place to start with. Because it really, you're playing with the symbols of power that created a lot of the problems that we are going to experience and we're experiencing now, especially through neglect of doing the right policies. And so we're taking down the symbols of power.
And if you look at Andrea's work, you will see he uses all manner of monuments as sort of icons of that use of power, lack thereof, or messed up. There also is a tremendous amount of responsibility on people. great lead by example on ways we can do a heck of a lot better just with our own daily doings, in our neighborhoods, our communities. Even it can blow out to a county if it becomes a major success. We have a woman here by the name of Annette Olson, who is just about a finest in this zone, and she happens to be in our backyard in Washington, D.C. Why don't you tell us a bit about what you do and why you do it?
Yes, so I'm a former field biologist and worked in West Africa for a while on my doctorate, and there, in a different way, I saw the future in terms of massive deforestation. And so that kind of inspired me. I actually had to flee because of the Civil War. So I wound up here in DC, working at the National Zoo and then the Smithsonian Institution, and working some on exhibits, some of which dealt with forces of change, the change on our environment. And I did a lot of research. I also talked to a lot of climatologists who really radiated fear, so about what was going to happen. So anyway, we did a few exhibits. I went on to other things, but that was always in the back of my mind.
Tell us exactly what you're doing now with your neighborhoods.
Right.
How granular it is, how effective.
Yeah. So I have three projects. The one that Amy and Jordan contacted me about is Green Neighbors CC, and it's a hyper-local community effort to try and pull together action on the ground, help people who want to do something really get out there and do impactful work. So, and a lot of that involves, it's not just personal actions. I've done a few personal actions, like I've installed a green roof, but it is often stuff like joining a planning committee when the city requests planning committees that have citizen representation. Writing letters, a person.
But before you get there.
Okay.
Am I off target? No, seriously.
Yeah.
Because those of us who are hearing this in planning, what would I say in that planning committee? Letters, what would I write in that letter?
Yes.
What's the incentive? What's the draw? And why is it successful? Get us to the nitty gritty.
Okay. Nitty gritty is this Green Neighbor started because of climate change. And the fear is DC is going to change with climate change. And we have a responsibility, we all have a responsibility. And so some of those things that are going to happen include like heat waves, massive heat waves in the future. How do we help plan for that? A change in equity in DC because of the heat waves, because some neighborhoods like this one have beautiful trees and others do not. There are flooding issues, invasive diseases, invasive species, like believe it or not, the armadillo is heading this way. And so trying, they're following the fire ants.
That was my school mascot.
Oh, okay. So, So climate change isn't just about sea level rise and affecting the coast, and it will affect the Potomac, but it affects also, almost every aspect. So
we're looking at India.
Yes.
Sorry, Pakistan.
Yes.
Yes. What has transpired in Pakistan is just breathtaking. The damage that these floods have done are taking well over half
a third.
Well over a third? It's over a third. Landscape.
Yeah.
How is this something that you look into the future, you see us submerged?
The U.S. has a lot of high ground, but it does have communities that are very low. The Potomac and the Anacostia are tidal in many respects. The Mall, is if the Greenland ice cap melts, the Greenland ice, rises up 10 feet, 20 feet at least, and more. So yes, yes, there will be communities.
So what are you working on? What are you working on now on a neighborhood by neighborhood basis? That really big granular stuff that's really affecting change.
Yeah. So one of the things we've come into is, well, one, we're organizing environmental tours. So for issues that are specific to DC, like there is a Superfund site in DC, which a lot of people don't know about. The Anacostia River used to be 30, 40 feet deep, and now it's 2 to 12 feet deep and loaded with toxins. Finding out what our strengths and our weaknesses are really will help us adapt. The other key project that we just started last year is we're helping jumpstart DC's tool library, which is basically you go and check out tools. And this is great in many ways because, you know, there's some, no houses are being built in DC anymore. It's all condos. People don't have space to store tools. We can't afford space to store tools. You don't waste as much, you don't buy as much, you save money. Tools donated at the richer end get shared with others who can't afford tools. And a lot of tools are help with community resilience. And that's one of the things we're really striving for. And I'll be talking to Andrea more about this, is helping build community resilience to disasters. So, you know, we have construction tools. It's not just garden tools. It's
fishing events across the city. I ran into one at Pierce Mill, the old Pierce Mill, in the park. Remarkable garden, community garden that has all manner of everything. It's a multi-season garden. And to see that kind of attention and interest in our land, I just assume would become a much bigger interest in waterline issues.
Yeah.
But without letting the global link to Pakistan, we just had a major storm on Ida that killed a bunch of people, especially in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, right? So I think the one of the things we're seeing is more frequent and more extreme rain events. So the district not only will it as a risk of flooding from riverine flooding from the Potomac River. So if you imagine snow caps in West Virginia, if they melt really fast and there's a big rain event in West Virginia, the Potomac River swells really fast, and then, you know, areas like Georgetown can be at risk. You can also have storm surge from the Chesapeake Bay, so, you know, we got lucky a few times with that.
Where is your office to deal with these kinds of prospects?
So we are doing probably, working as hard as probably any city in the U.S., if not more.
What are you working on?
I personally, I have two projects. One is I am analyzing all the floodplains in the district, all the communities and floodplains. There's this 17. And we are looking at objective data to prioritize which one we need to plan flood resilience for first. So we're looking especially at demographics and equity. So for instance, so that's basically we're creating a strategy for the entire district. At the more granular level, right now I'm doing a plan for southwestern Buzzard Point where there's this giant floodplains that bisects the peninsula right now. And we have three giant public housing communities in the middle of that floodplain. Because if you know Southwest looks so different, right? All those 60s and 70s buildings, that's because Southwest was the first and biggest urban renewal project in the country, where thousands of people their houses were demolished and were moved out by the federal government. When Southwest was rebuilt, by chance, probably not, public housing ended up in the middle of the floodplain. New Southwest. So now we have thousands of people there, which is a giant equity issue, but it's also a giant problem for emergencies. Evacuating some of the residents in one of these communities reports that half of them are single seniors or disabled. So in a major flood, they have to move out to safety. People are senior, living alone and disabled is a major issue, right? So we're doing a plan for that. But I think like in terms of like, I think what climate change is doing to us and our cities and what we need to figure out is that it's challenging everything we knew from how we build our storm sewers, how we build our sewer and our storm drain infrastructure, how we build roads. Roads have always been engineered to get stormwater away. We might actually have to purposely flood some roadways in certain events. We might have to design our parks to be floodable. The idea is that we need to figure for cities like DC that will have more rain, not less, we need to figure out how to live with water. That might mean actually recreating some of the creeks that 100 years ago we destroyed and we put under streets. We might have to flood some of our parks purposely, right? So that's the difference. It's like for a long time, engineering was all about keeping water away. Now we need to engineer to bring water where we want it to go rather than where water might want to go. And that's going to challenge everybody in terms of like parking. But if you're in a floodable street, you know, you have car insurance, but you know. You know what I mean? Like we need to, that's going to challenge transportation engineers, they're going to go crazy with that concept, insurance companies, but that's the cost of climate change. And so really here, we can't just say, I don't like that. We haven't done anything. I mean, I was growing up in, you know, 80s, and I remember we were already talking about climate change and we haven't done anything, let's be frank. So. And so for decades, we've heard people talk about the price of climate change, and we think it's going to be, it's already now, we're spending millions of dollars in retrofitting all our storm infrastructure. We're going to have to spend millions of dollars in designing our parks, our streets, levees. It's there, and we're really doing it now. But there's some exciting stuff about it, too. Like, everybody likes water, so if you engineer it well, more waterfront is actually nice, more parks, more trees. Those are some of the things we need more of, or things that everybody should be able to get behind, like more trees.
What about these areas? We talked about equity issues, both of you mentioned it, and it's a very important issue. In areas like ours, and of course, New Orleans, and I mean, they're all over the country, but very, very vulnerable populations living in high risk, you know, environmental. Can the district work on those issues?
Yeah, so we
are. I understand the evacuation, but I mean, more on the.
Yeah, all the areas that we're prioritizing have an equity issue. Like, you know, one of the floodplains we're working on right now is Potts Branch in Ward 7 because of equity issues. Hobson Run in Ward 8 because of equity issues. Southwest, even though it's in Ward 6, people in Ward 6. Ward 6 is very diverse, and in this floodplain, again, we have thousands of people in public housing, so we're definitely prioritizing those. But we're also coming up with, you know, projects, programs for everybody. Like, we're launching now something called Flood Smart Homes, which is designed around another successful program by the District Department of Energy and Environment, which is River Smart Homes. Basically, we're going to come and assess your home for flood risk, and we're going to either give you a grant or subsidize or somehow hook you up with services that you need to make your house more flood resilient.
Do you have enough staff to address those kind of issues? Do you take
on? We have five staff. Yeah. I just spoke to the city of Philadelphia, but it's bigger flood risk than we have, and one staff.
Wow.
So.
Wow.
So we're doing okay, we're doing our best. I think the district is, we surprised, we're doing really.
Is there any opportunity for volunteer work in this, in these areas of floodplains and vulnerable areas? I'm going to ask you that also.
If I can say, that's another one of the projects we work on as Green Neighbors DC is we will take bees set up booths at farmers markets to let people know about programs such as River Smart and other programs that are available, because you know, there can be government initiatives, but many times it's the residents and the people who have to implement them, they have to live with them. So getting buy-in for permeable papers and so on is really
permeable papers. So something like the water can go through.
Yeah.
But you have to get community buy-in.
Well, if they're going to install them in their driveways, mm-hmm. yeah.
Solar. I mean, solar for the maybe not the maybe for single house, single home. Is solar catching on at a community level and a neighborhood level? Does it have that appeal, people multiplier impact?
Oh, it does.
And solar. Tell us about that.
So solar. Well, what behavior science has found is that neighbors greatly influence neighbors, and if you want change, you start in a neighborhood, and the neighbors will work with other will influence other neighbors. So there was a study done of solar panels being put on houses in Seattle. And well, Seattle's a little biased towards, you know, great new initiatives, but they found that one house putting solar on led to 32 other houses in the immediate neighborhood putting solar on because they saw a neighbor put solar on, and they were like, oh, this is acceptable. So that's very key, and there are programs in the city for helping people get solar. And so I actually did mine through a co-op, but there's Solar for All, I believe, is the program that helps people of low income get solar. So yeah. So if it starts, and when I installed solar, one of my neighbors saw it, and she installed solar. So I know from personal experience it works.
How about you?
I was going to say that in Southwest, because I'm working there a lot, there's a community group called Southwest. So there's a neighborhood organization called Southwest Neighborhood Assembly. And then a community of residents and volunteers organized only on disaster mitigation in the community. So that if a disaster were to hit, everybody, or at least a lot of people in the community, know where to go get what and which residents to look out for. So that's one of the big things in disasters, is knowing where your more vulnerable neighbors are and make sure that you go and check in on them, that kind of thing, and bring supplies. So they're organizing as a community doing that, which is really something that as a government we can't substitute. We can't know, I mean, we know it through census, but census is not for good reasons, the address level. So we know we're generally vulnerable populations are, but only your neighbors.
That you touch, that you contact. And is that part of a strategy for your office?
That's just the resident. So one of the residents is a retired FEMA guy, so he's so excited about that work.
Yeah.
So that's how he chose his school and uses retirement time.
Is there a way to deploy volunteers to that kind of work to the team of folks to spread out and various vulnerable areas?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean,
I think it's been done in other cities, but I don't know for DC, but I know that during COVID there was definitely
a lot of that. Yes.
And here in DC about check on your neighbors.
Yes.
And so I'm sure that can be translated over to disaster.
Very important. There's another organization in town that's environmentally oriented. It's called the New Classroom. And they started in Baltimore, and it is the I think it's the largest after school program. After school goes all the way up to the 40s. But it is a remarkable program here in Washington and in a number of districts here. And they run Kingdom Island. So they introduce youngins in elementary school to water, to land, to a place that is perhaps far beyond what they may have only been custodial, you know, responsibility. And it would be great if you could, you know, press a button and multiply the kind of initiative times, you know, one. I'm going to open this up to folks, and I would love to hear what works for you, what you're curious about, common theory, et cetera, right over there. And introduce yourself if you would, because we have a very interesting group of folks here.
My name is Dixie Newton, and I live in Chevy Chase, Maryland, and I'm interested in all of this, and the art. I have a starter question, just based on my ignorance, which is, why is the Potomac so polluted?
Why is the
Potomac? Why is it so polluted? Because presumably, if it's polluted and it rises in its water level, then lots of other bad things are going to happen, and I'm just, I don't really understand why it is polluted as it is.
I have a question relative to this, a sub-question. In high school, I was with a crazy guy, and we capsized in the Potomac, salmon. We get back, and my father insists that I get a tetanus shot. I did. Is it better?
Is it better than about your
1970?
Actually, probably yes. I would say probably yes, because before the Clean Water Act, American rivers caught on fire, right? So I would guess probably yes. Why is the Potomac and the Annette Olson River more polluted? It's mostly due to something called the CSO, the combined sewer overflow. It's basically old cities, especially in the old part, they have a combined piping system underground that combines storm water and rainwater. What happens is they're built for the capacity that we needed 100 years ago. Obviously, the population has gotten bigger, and we also have bigger rain events, so we have more stormwater to have to treat.
And more concrete.
When the system gets to capacity, which is pretty fast, it's a pretty quick process, then the system shuts down, and because the blue plains, which is where we treat our water, just has a level of capacity, and then the rest of the water just goes straight into the rivers without treatment.
But what's the place to put in? You want to put in above if you're boating or if you're putting your toes in?
Yeah. You only want to put above the sewage treatment.
Yeah, that's exactly. Why, generally speaking.
Always above, but there's always one above you. So, you know, it's a big river.
There's a group called Anacostia River Keepers, and they give tours of the Anacostia River, and they explain more about the history of that. But there were munition plants along the Anacostia River. There's chemical runoff. There's and the former landfill turned Superfund site that caught on fire, and it's drainage. But they said that the Anacostia River, because so much work has been done on it, that it's supposed to become swimmable in 2027. It's not swimmable now.
Down the sediments.
Yeah.
It's in the sediment, and it's bad. And but you know, the waste stream is coming out of industries up to the Potomac Channel, or the other feeder rivers, as well as the Anacostia River, are much cleaner today, with much more control over it. So the water itself is fine. You don't want to eat you can't eat fish at bottom feed, like catfish and those kinds of things, because they're eating off the bottom. But the water quality of the Potomac and the Anacostia is far better than it's ever been in the last 50 years. So it gets better every year.
There is pressure to open it up for a little swimming.
Mm-hmm. Well, the plans are for the Anacostia is to put swimming docks offshore in the middle of the river where it is deeper, and where the water flows. And so that's happening in a couple
of
years.
It's a handful of years away to be technically safe for swimming. Now, the Anacostia River is just a very muddy river by water, so it's never going to be Caribbean blue, even if it's like the bacteria is very low or whatever. It's just a muddy river, but it's going to be safe.
What's your name?
Sure. My name is Michelle Joseph. This is a wonderful event. I'm really excited to be here. Two questions, and it's a dovetail based on what you were talking about, the classrooms, living classrooms.
Yes.
I work with middle and high school students. This generation, Gen Z, is very excited about and passionate about climate change and climate action. What volunteer organizations are going to be focused on, say, planning, say, working with waters that are working with that particular demographic group? And I also work with those who are in underserved communities. So I'd love to hear your take about that, back to your generation. Anyone else?
Okay, I'm sure you've heard of Sunrise. Sunrise is branching out a lot from, Sunrise are usually high school kids who do strikes, or school strikes, or protests, or things like that, but they're branching out into a lot of volunteer activities. So, which is excellent. Friday's for the future, a little bit too.
And it's all local?
They have local chapters.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
These are all volunteer organizations, and it would be a website, it would be,
It would just type in Fridays for the Futures DC or Sunrise DC, and you'd probably land on that support.
I just talked to Fridays for the Future DC last night,
for the first time, and we talked about working with them. Green Neighbors DC tends to be an older population. We don't have many youth involved, and we'd really like to, because they have a lot more energy than I do. And but there's also, what would be great is to tie in these opportunities to class credits or something. We had a volunteer at the tool library who wanted to be able to get class credit for her volunteer, or civil duty volunteer work. So yeah, but that's about as much as I know. There are some in Anacostia. There's a wonderful youth group in Anacostia, and I don't remember it, but I will look that up for you.
Well, I also am not an expert. I don't work with youth much in my day job, but Earth Conservation Corps in Southwest Navy Yard.
Earth Conservation Corps. Okay.
I know we even fund it as an agency in grant form, and I think they do a lot of environmental education with youth, especially along the river. So
that's
like they take them out on boats and get out the river.
Hi, my name is Matthew Horwich. First of all, like really commend this talk. It's been really interesting. And second, I like identify as Gen Z. And I guess one thing about my generation is I feel like we're really interested in climate action, but I think it's been tough for me personally to feel like I'm doing stuff in my day-to-day life or in my general community. And then see kind of like billionaires or really mass projects that are kind of undoing some of the work of climate action or kind of far hearing some of the detrimental impacts of climate change. And I was just wondering how anyone kind of combats some of that nihilism. And I think that's something that Gen Z struggles with a lot, is just kind of feeling a little hopeless.
I have an example from the real world. Right now, and so my family is in Europe, right? And there's this horrible war in Ukraine that has obviously way more horrible for Ukrainians, but it's also affecting obviously inflation in the US, but in Europe it's affecting the energy market like really drastically. And I have family there, and we do not feel what they're feeling in Europe with energy. We're complaining about the $4 gas at the pump, which has already gone down. But in Europe, everywhere right now, governments are asking people to really increase their energy use at home with just simple things like not start your AC unless you're really dying. feet, things like that. I think in Europe, generally speaking, people are a little bit culturally more prone to doing things like that because for more years, governments have been telling people to be more environmentally sensitive. But I think the nihilism part, I'm going to get to it, is I also have the same feeling when I read about celebrities taking a personal jet to go grocery shopping mile away, right? And I'm like, well, that's just summed up all my efforts for my entire life. But I think that if European governments are asking small everyday people to just, you know, be mindful of their electricity use at home, there must be still a very high impact that we as just regular, normal, private jet people are doing. If the governments feel like we, by just not using the dishwasher for a month, we can impact the European energy market.
I don't think that is necessarily the good formula in the United States, though, because we are so destabilized politically. And I think the thing why we during a very tough time in inflation is not going to swing in the United States. It'll swing, but it'll swing very, very polarizing. That is my assumption, given how we have sort of reacted to, the masks. We've had a lot of intense reactions.
Are there other questions in here?
So my day job is I run a nonprofit called Climate Steps, and this is one of the things that we deal with a lot, is people want to know what they can do to fight climate change, and they want to know if they can have an impact. And you actually can. And you can through the ripple effect, as we talked about, for solar. But you can also do it through, that's kind of a passive effect, but you can have an active effect in changing infrastructure. And that just really blows things out of the water, because if you help your city change its infrastructure, then you're doing it for a great amount of people.
And that's exactly what you're saying.
Yes, exactly, yep. Now, a lot of my neighbors were furious about the bike lane that's just put in our street. But, so you have to buy-in, and it can't be top-down. As we, Andrea and I were talking about before, so you're talking, it has to be a partnership. But things like that do actually create enough of an impact that you're going to save a part of the planet through it.
And also, such an important element of this conversation tonight, and why we invited all of you, is because it's about community. This fosters community, and community we have had, we've lost, as John mentioned. You know, it's community that these kinds of actions, Andrea and Annette are talking about, build trust, build interest, build senses of please keep that up there. But it's just it, the community aspect is of the essence of this. And that is helps drive and combat that feeling of, oh my God, I just did this, I worked by Randolph, and look at this big, bold action by this guy, woman, man, they don't care a darn about, and they're degrading much more quickly than I can ever beat that back. But if we don't do something, whoa, steamrollers coming our way.
There are two personal actions you can do that are really important. One is insulate. And
tell us nuts and bolts.
Nuts and bolts is our houses leak like crazy. Around each window, it's like a brick of open air. So caulk your windows first. I went down from $240 a month to $180 just by caulking around my windows. The other is insulating, you know, attic insulating around the water heater and all that fun stuff. Talking, getting an energy audit so that, which the city provides to analyze your house.
What are you renting an apartment?
Talking to your landlord, and I rented an apartment if he bought the insulation, I'd insulate the attic. And he did, and I did, and I, yeah, anyways, dusty, yeah, but it worked. You know, people want to save money, so that's a nice benefit. But the other action is to be more plant-based. Now, there's a group out there called Project Drawdown that done analyses of what are the most impactful collective and personal actions, and going more plant-based is one of the top five. It's a huge, and not wasting food. The food aspect is really big. So those two are personal actions.
But the rest,
the methane that's produced, the factory farming, but also most of our meat in the U.S. actually comes from the Amazon area. It's imported. And most people don't know that, but they go, it comes from Texas, from my dad, who happens to be a cattle rancher, by the way. And I've been vegetarian for 30 years, but we still talk.
That's it. Andrea, what do you have for us in terms of the community? I mean, you straddle some interesting worlds. The get it done world, yeah. The plan to get it done world, and then the idea and portray it.
When it comes to community, I mean, actually Stella here and I did a project 13 years ago.
Stella, introduce yourself. Stella's been the
lawyer. So I feel like I'm an old friend, so I've known both of our presenters for a number of years. I'm Stella Tarnay, I'm co-founder of Capital Nature, and you are digging in my lands, in my garden. Everything you're saying is stuff I either love or I'm working on. I'm really doing this conversation about neighborhoods, because I think there's so much we can do at the neighborhood scale that's really helpful and also healing. So one of the things we haven't had a chance to talk about is, I mean, I get to talk about it, thank you, Amy, because at Capital Nature, we just started, we pitched DDOT and said, I think you can get the Department of Transportation, the Tree Division.
Even us,
didn't get that acronym.
So they plan to take care of all of the street trees in the city. And it's really important during climate change that people start taking even better care of trees. And so I pitched Earl, who runs the tree division, said, Earl, I think you need to get people to love the trees more. And I said, I think we should do neighborhood tree walks. And Casey Trees is already doing it, but I wanted to dig into the cultural fabric of the neighborhood. So starting in Mount Pleasant, my neighborhood, we're doing seasonal walks, and we're going to look at the same trees during different seasons. And so at the end of the year, we'll learn what a sycamore tree looks like at the beginning versus at the end. And I led a walk just this last week, not too long for too long, but I had a very mixed generational group, and I was reminded of your Gen Z question, because I had some great Gen Z questions. And, they were talking about the trees, and I said, well, you know, an oak supports over 500 species of life. And they go, wow.
That's remarkable.
It's not remarkable.
That's remarkable.
And then I said, now this great myrtle is really pretty. I said, do you want to know how many species of life it supports? And I put up my finger and I said, 3.
Yeah.
They go, what? And suddenly it was about native species versus imported species. And then one of the Gen Z people said, but I bet in China that crepe rum supports many more. And he was absolutely right. It's like understanding how things work in the ecology. And what really encouraged me was, like, not only did we learn about the trees, but people were chatting with each other. And at the end of the tour, they didn't want to leave. And they were like, hey, you want to have coffee? So we were like, the trees were an introduction to the social connections of the neighborhood.
Right.
So I'm so interested in what else you're doing.
Yeah, and we've had speakers for Green Neighbors DC, and we have a website. I want to share that with our audience.
Your website is
greenneighborsdc.org. Yeah.
Andrea's is?
My first name, Andrea, and my really annoying, big, long last name, Limauro.
Why is that? That's a good one. Wow.
It's really like, it's a lot of vowels.
.com. Oh, well, website.
That part is.
We have a few more questions we're going to cover.
Yep.
I was just going to comment, adding to yours and to the Gen Z question over there, that my college alumni were
uphill, but they would probably be willing to partner with other college alumni groups. Yeah. So if it's something that you wanted to connect and organize, then
it's a great idea.
Yeah.
Actually,
it's a great idea.
With schools.
So many levels of network. Yeah. Anybody have a question over here? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question building off Matthew's question. My name is Annie, and I live in Hartford. And I work in the environmental sector, and I just constantly
give us who you are and where you're from.
Okay. Sorry?
Your name and your...
Yeah, hi, my name is Annie, and I live in Hartford. I'm originally from upstate New York.
Gotcha.
And just building off Matthew's question, I work in the environmental sector, and I'm constantly wrestling with just the dichotomy between working in the environmental sector and feeling like I'm helping, and also just being overcome with, as Matthew said, nihilism. And I'm wondering, in your work, which your lives have been dedicated to this, and thinking about this for your whole lives, how, on a more personal level, do you recognize, whether it's through art, through the community work, you've alluded to this, kind of good question, what makes you hopeful, and then how do you cope with your own anxiety and maybe sorrow about the future?
Who's taking it first?
You're
looking at me.
Okay. Well, I have two kids, so I do look into the future for them. And okay, so where I'm hopeful is that I have two kids, and they're really smart, and they really get it. And all the younger generations I know, they get it so much more than we do. That I'm a Gen Xer and generations before mine. So I'm hopeful because I think they're just smarter generations. I think that we got comfortable. I think people, it's just normal. Like, you just get comfortable and then, you know, you don't want to suffer anymore. You work on your life. It's very selfish. But, you know, the next generations are just smarter. They get it. I mean, just the way my daughter talks about it, she's so angry. but I think it's good. I mean, you have to be angry because you have to become a, I think climate has to drive our votes. I mean, it's not just for too long it's been like this thing that, you know, also if you talk about climate for a minute, you know, it's the bonus, it's the extra thing. I think climate, we need to build a generation of climate voters who can influence our elections, because we suck at electing good people, so we need to rely on the next people who are going to turn 18 now. And I think it's through creating climate voters. It has to become the top of the agenda. And even the Republican Party, apparently, you know, they're starting, they went from denying climate change exists to saying it exists, it's not our fault. Hey, it's a step forward, it exists, so it's something we have to fix and work towards, I guess. I think my optimism is really just the new generations.
And kind of addressing the therapy that I do for myself, I now, every evening, I do paper mache and just work with my hands. I'm also renovating my house, so I will let out my tension on my house. And that's great, but I get pressured because there's so much to do, and I see a lot of people not step, you know, they're like, oh, this is important, but they're not doing anything themselves. They're expecting other people to do things, and we can't wait for other people to do things now. We just don't have that much time to really prevent bad, we already have disasters, but it can be catastrophic. In DC, the predicted number, so right now we average 9 days a year, 95 plus 3 days. This is not going to help your view, I'm sorry. By 2100, we're going to average 85 days a year, 95 plus 2 days.
How many?
85.
Basically, our summers are a little. The days with 95 degrees and up are going to triple. So if the summer sucks in DC now, by 28, it's going to suck
triple.
But there are good things. There are good things.
I wanted to take one.
Nobody should talk.
these existing issues instead of, as you say, talk about it in a bonus for 5 minutes and you're good.
Yeah, I think there has been a sea change. When I started Climate Steps 5 years ago now, I was the only website dealing with action in the US, really. And now there are massive numbers. There are massive numbers of people who want to take action. There's still some loss. They're lost a little bit how to.
That's your job.
Yeah, that's my job. And but I think there have been some movements that have really changed some things. The infrastructure.
Is your popular push to protect what we have?
Yes, there is. It's interesting because it definitely has places on the west and east coast, but not for what reasons you think. In the central U.S., the climate has been more variable for longer periods, for 100 plus years. So people expect the climate to be variable.
Very interesting. You would assume that the coasts were because of the
reactions. Yeah. The U.S. in general, compared to the rest of the world, the climate has been more variable over time, whereas the rest of the world is seeing the impact much more greatly. So as people get impacted directly, things are going to change, and people are. So they're seeing it.
Thanks, Shelly. How about you? And you better not say you said about asking another question.
Well, no, I think that there are going to be some good opportunities also that come out of. So if we embrace of seriously climate resilience, for instance, in my work, what that means is more parks, more green spaces, more trees in parks. Parks that don't suck, they're actually awesome because if you have a park that is designed to flood, then you have a water feature if you do it right. With like meandering, wooden bridges, and you can have this, So, like for instance, we have a very urban park in the southwest called Lansford Park that serves one of the public housing communities. Well, through this project, and I got $80 million from FEMA to do it, we're going to transform the park into a public car park that has older features and nature, which brings a lot of mental health benefits to people and children. So there's through this, there's opportunities to actually make our cities better, more green.
And if you're not a professional in this space, as these two are, and I'm not into tuition, if you're not a professional, there are plenty of volunteer opportunities. Organizations, we named a few, but there are many in town to get involved with Tricia. Patricia Day is, where's Jordan? Jordan's our gallery manager and the best of us. And Tricia Day is back with us after a little hiatus, and she's on our gallery staff. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I have a question and a comment. The first one is for you, Andrea. When you're talking about